entire country right now. And these calls continue every week because Liz puts the time and the energy to make sure that they happen, regardless of all the different things that are going on in her life. It's the whole world hearing this right now. Regardless of all the different things, five children, and who knows the different things that are going on in her life, and all the wonderful excuses she can have to skip a week. One thing she expressed to me, how it was really important just to keep it going, because if you miss 1 week, then you miss 2 weeks, and then, you know, you miss a month, and then the whole momentum is died. So I just want to acknowledge Liz for that, and if I'm going to give her a round of applause.
A lot of people in this room are part of the team. And they share the acknowledgement.
Yeah, okay, to let you know where I'm coming from, they share the acknowledgement. But every week when she sends out the email for the agenda for the call, she writes a whole paragraph acknowledging someone. And she just acknowledges and acknowledges and acknowledges every week someone new. And I don't even know how you come up with all these different names of people every. So I thought it would be good to acknowledge her back. Now, I don't write much, but if I wrote it, it would take me like a half hour to put together one of the paragraphs that she writes, because it's really well thought of. And I think now, on the last email, I think you acknowledged Kristen, did you?
I sure did.
All right, you sure did. So, let's bring up our next speaker, Kristen Andrews. I'm not sure what you're talking about.
So I just quietly ate like this for
raised money for them, and found out about the raids on the farms. I read about Martin Gold, who was a Mennonite farmer who had $65,000 worth of cheese making equipment stolen, robbed from him, and his buying club shut down. I read about Jackie Stowers in Ohio, who ran O'Mana's Storehouse, which was a lot like the buying club that I was in. She had a great idea of, she found 40 Amish farms around her that had no way to get their product to market. So one week she would go out and get the food and bring it back for her neighbors, and the following week a neighbor would go out, so she started this, and this private club of hers got bigger and bigger. And the Ohio Department of Agriculture caught wind of it, went in with 9 armed agents and kept six kids that were in the house at the time hostage for 6 hours while they tore apart her downstairs, took her computers, took her cell phones, took her food for her personal use, and her food from her buying club. On the warrant, it said that they had alleged their degree misdemeanor of operating a retail establishment without a license, which they were never charged with. But they were terrorized. And I read about Jane Stewart, who operated the Rossum Foods Club in Venice, California, a private buying club very much like ours, because we have the Rossum Club in Concord, Massachusetts also, same club. And he is currently in jail for operating this club. Being prosecuted, he's being charged with a felony. The felony is conspiracy, and the conspiracy is to sell raw milk, which is a misdemeanor. If you're talking about bringing it over state lines and selling it, it is actually legal in California. So I don't understand these charges, and hopefully James will be okay. Ajay, would you like to pipe in with that?
He has 59 counts against him.
59
criminal counts. And hopefully, so we're talking about stacking counts, and he is direct example of how scare tactics are used.
Yeah, that's overreaching. Ajna is James' lawyer, so hopefully she will update you on his case during dinner. So all of these raids really upset me, and I couldn't sleep at night, and I had to do something, and I sought out the mainstream media, trying to get someone to pay attention, and finally this one guy that I really wanted to make the movie. He did documentaries for CNN. He asked me to go out to lunch, and I thought that he was going to tell me that he was going to make the movie, and instead he said, if you want this done, you have to do it yourself. So I set out across the country, and I interviewed these people that had been raided, and made the movie from it. And now, I wasn't a filmmaker at all, but it's just funny, like every step of the way, someone would come into my life that would help me with the next step, so I got all my footage, and I was quite depressed after interviewing all these people and dealing with, they were terrorized. They all had post-traumatic stress disorder too. And it was just, I'm not a real reporter, so I got emotionally involved with, and I'm very close friends with all the people that I interviewed. So
that's what they should get when they come back from war.
Yeah.
From work.
No, I know. They all had it. It's very serious being terrorized like that, like with your kids there and everything taken from you. It's very violating. So I got back with my footage and my camera person and another guy that was helping me told me, I have no story. This is absolutely boring. No one's ever going to watch your film. And so then luckily my editor came into my life and produced the Far Beyond concerts, and he took me the next step. And as soon as I was done with that, a distributor came into my life and helped me get into theater. So it just all along the way, even though I'm not a filmmaker, or I wasn't a filmmaker, people have just taken it to the next level. It's because they care about this issue. It's because they saw it and they wanted to get involved and charge less or whatever, and then helped me get the job done. And that was great. So now I'm using the film to help. What I really want to do is get the numbers up there of people that know about this. I really think that the people are outraged about the raids, and the more that we can let the people know that this is what their money's being spent on, hopefully we can make a difference. So in Massachusetts, so the FDA right now has an initiative, for those of you that don't know, it's called Healthy People 2020. One of the objectives in this initiative, so they have monthly meetings with your state health departments, every state. And so one of their objectives is to reduce the number of states that allow the sale of raw milk and to make it harder for the people to purchase milk, or to make it more difficult, or to make stricter regulations in the states that do allow it. So in Massachusetts, we're allowed to buy it off the farm, which is great. But like I said, we send refrigerated trucks out. So the health departments or whoever in your states are in charge of the farms. It's different, you know, in charge of the milk. It's different in every state who takes the eggs, who takes the... So in our state, the health department put pressure on the Massachusetts Department of Agriculture. Their response under this pressure is to tell us that it's illegal for us to carpool to get our milk. So and then we couldn't have, they sent grandmother a cease and desist order for going to pick up milk for her grandchildren and bringing it back. They sent our refrigerated truck a cease and desist order and a bunch of carpool clubs in Boston cease and desist order. So it was crazy. It said that they were breaking the law for carpooling. So but luckily we have the number. Do you have a question? So luckily we have the numbers and a lot of powerful people now that are, you know, that are drinking raw milk and finding it's great for their health. So we were able to get a lot of people in Massachusetts. We got a cow, and we milked the cow with Boston Common, and we went in and told the commissioner that we won't stand for this, and it's injustice, and we need to carpool to get our milk. We can't all be driving a car out 2 hours, you know, back and forth, and we need to get our milk. And he maintained after that it's illegal. But for the time being, it's illegal to carpool. This isn't on the book. It's just something they made up. It's illegal for us to carpool, but for the time being, they're looking the other way. So, and they don't have any intent to arrest us. So, but we do have, luckily in our town now, we have big numbers of people that are carpooling, and we have doctors and lawyers. And the woman, Hillary, who told on me and told me I was crazy and freaked out, well, a few years later, this is about a 10-year span, a few years later, her daughter had horrible eczema all over her body. And she decided to try raw milk, and her daughter was completely healed. And now she...
Yes!
She runs our Rawson Food Club in Boston. And so, yeah, and so, and she, and also she's been teaching raw foods classes and raw milk classes in our town, and just so we have about 60 members in our town. So these numbers help. It'll be interesting to see if they ever decide to arrest us, to prosecute us for even ticket us for carpooling. It'll be interesting because we do have the numbers, we do have, you know, there's power in numbers. So all I keep doing is just talking about it and you know, trying to get people to talk to their legislators about it. The two bills that Ron Paul and Rand Paul have right now that allow for the sale of raw milk on the state lines would be very helpful. So I was at Capitol Hill this morning. I have a couple senators that might help out. So that's why I'm dressed like this. So hands out the movies. If you have representatives or senators that might be interested, I'd be more than happy to get them a free movie and talk to them. And so I don't know. Just